happens that I have home to not watch the same movie more than once in the span of a year. I heard, yes. Can I get yes, all right. Let's get it back. Okay. Yeah. So I don't know what it is. I think it's seeing the same thing. I could have never, and this is no shame on any accounting. You are blessed by the Lord. I just cannot do anything that's redundant. I have a hard time with that. So if I see a movie more than once in the span of a year's time, it makes me go a little loopy. Now, here's the thing. Here's the reality. How did more children coming into my home? And so I can foresee the future. I got one now that's a 2.5-year-old. He doesn't ask for the same movies on repeat yet. And we got another one on the way. And that one, eventually, one day, just like Cairo, will eventually ask for the same movie. Not just one. So there's an issue that has come up in the Corinthian church. And the issue is this. The believers there are wondering if they should eat meat that was going to be sacrificed to idols. If you're sitting here this morning, you're like, that seems like a big deal to me. I like meat. In fact, what's the last coming up, so we're going to have a lot of it. Not a big deal. That is true. We shared some of our issues, our conversations that we had. Like, for example, they wouldn't understand it if we talked about movies and music that we should avoid. You have no frame of reference for it. I think the same is true. Because we don't really have a frame of reference for not eating meat sacrificed to idols. That's a foreign idea. So I want us to put ourselves in the shoes of a Christian in Corinth 2,000 years ago to understand their problem. So, for their church, here's what became tricky. They understood if they knew the meat to avoid, they would just avoid it. If that was an issue for them. But say you're a Christian in Corinth, and you got invited over to someone's house, and they made you a meal. How would you know if that meat had been, or was about to be sacrificed to an idol, unless you asked? Well, I'm glad you asked. And Paul gives us some examples here. So, Paul gives us a few different examples here. It says in verse 27, if you're going to look back there with chapter 10, verse 27, it says, if one of the unbelievers invites you there and you are disposed to go, eat whatever is set before you without raising any questions on the ground of conscience. So he's saying, if you get invited to this meal, don't ask. Don't ask where you came from, okay? Just do it. Just eat it. But, say, you're invited over. You have no clue if you're going to offend somebody by eating this meal that was supposed to be sacrificed to idols. What does verses 28 and 29 say? It says, but if someone says to you, this is an offer and sacrifice, do not eat it for the sake of the one who informs you and for the sake of the conscience. Verse 29 says, I do not mean your conscience, but for his. For why should my liberty be determined by someone else's conscience? So what Paul is telling us here is that if you were partaking this meal as a Christian, and you eating this meat would offend someone in the home, don't do it. You have Christian freedoms, but your freedom doesn't mean you force your freedom on somebody else in a way that might offend them. This is what Paul is saying. He's saying, you have to take your meat, follow my example, so that you can avoid offending somebody else. Now, what Paul is doing is an example for how to put people above our preferences, ultimately, for the sake of glorifying God. That's ultimately, at the end of the day, what is the goal of the Christian? It is to glorify God. So, I want to break this down into sections. So, go back with me to verse 32. I want to talk about how, when the people of preference, we are avoiding sin. Verse 32 says this. Give no offense to the Jews, or to the Greeks, or to the church of God. What he said in verse 32. Now, what does he mean? Well, he's meaning that you are not to offend others around you. And like I said a second ago, this includes believers. These are believers that are young in their faith. This is the church of God. And it also includes the unbeliever who would be offended by you as a Christian eating the meat that was supposed to be sacrificed to their idols. Again, I know this is a little bit confusing, but just to stay with me, it's going to make more and more sense as we go through this next year. Now, can we avoid offending everybody? Monitor. No, there's no way. There's no way. You want something, you say something, you do something, you may offend somebody. But what you can control is your motive. You can control your motive. And so, the scriptures are in God's heart for us is that we put our selfish preferences to death. There's a story I remember when I was in high school. I made fun of someone for wearing a LeBron James jersey. Now, what I'm about to say has nothing to do with the fact that he got knocked out in the first round. It's one clear to hear. At the time, me and my friend were walking home, and I saw a guy in front of me, and he was wearing a LeBron James jersey that LeBron had never worn. So what did I do? Well, I looked at my friend, pointed, laughed, and joked, and then I proceeded to say to my buddy, I was like, I wonder where he got that knockoff jersey. Guess what happened? The guy that was in front of him that I made fun of him turned around and looked dead at me. And at the time, I was in ninth grade. I'm probably a senior. What a smart move. Really dumb. And I started to pray. Lord, please protect me. And it did. Because after the guy glared me down, he just kept walking. Now, what did I do? I put my preference to make a joke about this person to humor myself and my friend above this person, above this individual. I cut off the chance of ever becoming this guy's friend because I insulted him. And that today is so easy to do. For the sake of cracking a joke, it is so, so easy to just let things fly and offend somebody at work, offend somebody at school, to offend somebody with their political affiliation? So easy to do. That's why James talks about the tongue. Impossible to control. So difficult. Now, what is Christ calling us to?
But God is calling us through this text, through the words of Paul, he's calling us, watch out. Live that self-sorted to death so that you might connect to somebody and not burn bridges. Now, here's the second thing I want to say. If we are going to put people above preferences, we must put others before ourselves. Look back with me at verse 33. He says, just as I try to please everyone in everything I do, not to be my own advantage, but that of any, that they may be saved. So, what is Paul saying here? What he's saying is that the goal of seeking the other person's good is ultimately so that they might be saved. Not so you can just have a happy life, but so that they might be saved. So don't tell them. And don't put yourself before them. Don't put your preferences before them, because ultimately your goal as a believer, if you're a believer here today, you want them to know Jesus. Don't get in the way. Avoid getting in the way. Now, I want you to take what was previously said in verse 32. Look back with me. Verse 32, he says, give no offense to the Jews or to the Greeks or to the church of God. Now, take that and put the verse 33 together, and it'll give you a complete thought here. So, what you should see is that we're to avoid offending someone, and by doing this, we will see the good of others so that they might be saved. We're not only to share the gospel, but we're to love people. We just talked about this. The greatest commandment is to love God, and the second is to like it. To love our neighbor, to love others. So we want to do that well. We don't want to just fire off the gospel and treat people poorly. That doesn't demonstrate the love of Christ. It should be the love in our words and our actions. If we truly love Christ, we love like Christ loves us. What gets in the way? Our pride gets in the way. And this is why Paul says, not seeking my own advantage. Not seeking my advantage. That's not the heart. That's not the goal. And in our world, how hard is it? In the Western context, especially, where we live in our Western world, from the time we get into grade school, through college, and into our career, we have been hit with, you need to seek your dreams, your ambitions, your goals, your aspirations. We're very individualistically thinking. And part of that is just to make it a society. And we live in that culture. And so our culture is not inherently wrong, but what I'm saying is, how easy is it in our type of individualistic culture is it for us to get that mindset? Me first. They can wait. We're very individualistically driven. So instead, Paul writes all throughout the New Testament, 2,000 years ago, things that still get home and true for us today. Paul says in Philippians 2:4, let each look not only to his own interest, but to the interest of others. In Romans 12:10, he says, love one another with brotherly affection. Outdo one another in showing honor. And in 1 Corinthians 9:19, he says, for though I am free of all, I have made myself a servant to all, that I might win more of them. So here's an idea. Maybe you have a whiteboard at work, or maybe you have one at home. Take some of these thoughts and put that up on a whiteboard. Maybe even like a leadership thing. Maybe write on there, if you want to be a leader, look towards the interest of others. If you want to be a leader, outdo one another in showing honor. If you want to be a leader, be a servant. Oh. How might that benefit the people you work with? How might that benefit the people you live with if you were to focus on that and make that the goal in your house, to make that the goal in your workplace? How might that benefit you? Ultimately, Jesus wants us to serve others so that we can talk about him to the people we encounter. That's Paul's hope. That in all things, we might win more people to Jesus. So, in order to put people above preference, we put others before ourselves. There's a third thing I want you to see. We put people above preferences when we imitate people who imitate Jesus. Found in 1 Corinthians 11:1. Says this, be imitators of me as I am of Christ. So this is an architect for all believers. Not the some, not the spiritually elite, but all Christians are to say with their life, hey, follow me. What I'm doing, what I'm living for, hey, follow this example. Because even if we say it or not, even if we think it or not, people already treat us that way. Think about that. What Paul is doing is he's just putting the obvious in the writing. He's stating the obvious. He's saying, hey, follow me, I follow Christ. Because that's what people will do. It's a natural default. Now, he's telling us that he's an example. He's not the main standard. He's not the one that we get our identity and purpose and meaning from. Paul's not saying he's that. That's why he says, follow me as I follow Christ. Christ being the same. Because here's what happens. Far too often in Christian culture, we will idolize other Christians. And in doing so, we put them on a pedestal that nobody else can reach. This is one of the reasons why so many big name Christians who have left the faith have caused others to lose their faith. Because we put them on such a high pedestal. And I'll submit this to you today that if we lose our faith because we put more focus on an imperfect person, we're putting more focus on that person than the person of Jesus. Let me say that again. If we are losing our faith, we put more faith in an imperfect person than we have in the person of Jesus. If we are losing our faith because of something horrible someone else did, whether it's recent or 10, 20 years ago, we put more faith in that person than we did the person of Jesus. And this is wrecking people right and left because they'll listen to a well-known preacher. They'll read a guy who's written tons of Christian books. And when they have decided to just do away with their faith, that person who's impacted has lost their faith too. The reason why there's so many who are deconstructing their faith because something has gone wrong in the church. Again, I'll say, people, we are putting too much focus on imperfect, wherever they say it, Christian, unchristian, I don't know, God knows, than we are on the person of Jesus. What does the scripture say about God? He is a rock. He is unmovable. He doesn't shift. He doesn't change. He is the same yesterday, today, and forever. This is why we can't put our hope and dreams and our focus on Christians and world. You are responsible for the life you live. Take care of that. Do well with that. And hopefully by your life you're saying, follow me, because I follow Jesus. Now I was praying about a mission statement. I saw many of y'all when I was reading 1 Corinthians 11 once in a while. And I'm finally getting to preach a verse I've talked about for a couple of years. And the reason that I chose 1 Corinthians 11:1 to be part of our mission statement is because it sets me, it sets our leaders, and it sets our students a whole example to live by, to follow. I don't want to say one thing and do another. I don't want our leaders and I don't want our students to say one thing and do another. I want for those of us who are saying, hey, I'm a follower of Jesus, to stand firm in that and be an example of that wherever that God is. I want that to be true. Our mission statement is to equip students to imitate Jesus. As a part of the church, the student ministry serves that function. That I want to, and our leaders want to lead students. We want to equip them so that they can imitate, they can be an example. What it means to follow Him. And this should be something we all hold true for ourselves. That as we say and we proclaim with our mouth that Jesus is Lord, and we believe in our hearts and we're saved by that, that we also live a life that demonstrates that. Because you, as a Christian, your life is on display for others to see and know that for others to see and know Jesus is. So in order to put people above preference, we are to imitate people who imitate Jesus. All right, we are at our last point here this morning, and the last thing I want you to see is that we put people above preference when we do everything to give God glory. I want to say it a different way. We give God glory when we put people above our preferences. At the end of the day, the Christian life is all about giving God glory. I want you to jump back to verse 31. I have these out of order on purpose. So verse 31, chapter 10 says this. So whether you eat or drink or whatever you do, do all for the glory of God. And the reason I put this at the very end of today's message is because it encapsulates the whole purpose and meaning of the Christian life. Glorify God. We want people to be saved. We want people to join community. We want people to be obedient to Jesus. But at the end of the day, you are responsible for your life. You are responsible to give God glory. Because there will be many people throughout your life where you have put off your preferences, you put off you being first place in your life, and instead serve them, and even still by your witness, they do not believe in Jesus. Jesus says, wide is the road that leads to destruction, and narrow is the pathway that leads to life. Very few in your life will come to saving knowledge of Jesus. And yet, that doesn't mean you're not successful in your Christian life. Success is not defined by how many people bring your saved. Success is defined by faithfulness. God is responsible for saving. God is responsible for changing. God is responsible for bringing and drawing people here. And right now, this morning, God is responsible for working on your part wherever you're at. If you are a long-time believer, if you're brand new to faith, or you could care less about God, God is the one drawing you to himself. And you, your responsibility is to respond in obedience to what God is doing. Not to put it off, not to put it off, but say, God, today you're saying something to my heart. Think about this. If you don't believe that faithfulness is success, think about Jesus. John chapter 6. Jesus has several disciples following, so many disciples following. And here's what happens in verse 53. So Jesus said to them, truly, truly, I say, unless you eat the flesh of the Son of Man and drink his blood, you have no life in you. Whoever feeds on my flesh and drinks my blood has eternal life, and I will raise him up on the last day. We pause there. For anybody that's never read this before, we're not cannibals. Just want to throw that out there, okay? We're not literally Jesus. We'll get to the spiritual meaning here. So he says in verse 60, jump there with me if you're there. When many of his disciples heard this, they said, this is a hard saying. Who can listen to it? But Jesus, knowing in himself that his disciples were grumbling about this, he said to them, you take offense to this? Then what if you were to see the Son of Man ascending from where he was before? It is the Spirit who gives life. The flesh is no help at all. The words that I have spoken to you are Spirit and life. That's the key understanding. Spirit and life. But there are some who don't believe. For Jesus knew from the beginning who it was that did not believe and who it was that would betray. And he said, this is why I told you, that no one can come to me unless it is granted by the Father. And after this, many of his disciples turned back and no longer walked with him. This is Jesus who had healed the blind, the lame, the deaf. This is Jesus who had all these incredible miracles, and yet, because he told them a tough thing and they didn't like it, they left. Here's his other disciples' response. And verse 67 says, he looked at the 12 and he said, "You want to know where to come?" Simon Peter answered, "Lord, to whom shall we go? You have the words of eternal life, and we believe and have come to know you are the Holy One of God." I think this is a good reminder for us today. When we start to doubt ourselves, when we start to doubt the impact and the influence of sharing the gospel has, inviting people to church has, praying for people, all the influence that has, we need to be reminded of Jesus' example, who he was, the power he has, and even still, most of his disciples, most of the followers walked away from him. And he had the 12 and then some ladies that were there too. Most of them walked away, even with whole thing doesn't weigh on your shoulders. But be faithful, and that is successful. In order to give God glory, we are to put people before our preferences. So this morning, what are some preferences you're putting before the people in your life? Maybe your consideration. Maybe something that looks good, but has become bad. Maybe it's your career. Maybe it's your goals, your ambitions, and your dreams. What has risen above people in your life? What is it that you need to give God today? This morning we have an opportunity for you to come up front and for you to talk to one of our ministers here. And we would love to pray with you. What we want you to know more than anything is how God saved your relationship with Jesus. See, Jesus, he lived a perfect life. He died on the cross. Your sins. And he didn't just die. He rose. He rose from the grave. Something you cannot do. If you were to die here without Jesus, you'd be forever separated from him and his goodness in heaven forever. And that's not something I want for you. So I pray, not if, but that God is drawing you. Today is the day that you can give your life to him forever. Forever.